little unit we change. If they don't fail, we're semi-happy. We do have other other testing techniques, like for example contract tests, which are gaining popularity. I haven't seen any friends using that, and I'm not using it because I'm in Red Hat, so I sit in Ivory Tower. We don't really do apps. Are you using contract tests in Skyscanner or any other companies you work? Okay, so it's worth to look at if you have a distributed system. I won't dive much into the details, but the idea is that you set the contract and then both provider and consumer has to fulfill it. So it's kind of like VSDL back in the days, where you could verify if stuff works without actually calling the other thing. So for the schema-less services, it's a pretty interesting thing to think. One of the JVM tools you can look at, which has also a Golang adapter, is called PACT, P-A-C-T. So yeah, have a look at that. Then the other slower tests, like integration tests, where you can use test containers or Aquilion. Then the end-to-end tests, which are slower, but still give you a level of confidence that you don't mess up the target system. But I mean, at the end of the day, it all boils down if the change I'm going to deploy will work on production, right? And if I do it on Friday, then I either run away and have a lot of beer, or my weekend is ruined. But in the past, when we look at it, and you, if you have been programming for more than 5 years, or maybe 8 years, Word was easier, right? We had monoliths. We are happy, productive developers having one single process and one blob of code, where it was very easy to reason about, it was easy to navigate, and we could easily verify if all the changes are working together. But then the web happened, right? Everything started to scale in enormous pace. If you have been using Twitter before 2012, you might have known this guy. And that was back in the days when they were on the monolith, and they really started having a lot of issues where all the celebrities jumped into Twitter. Right? So it was failing constantly because they couldn't scale the architecture to fulfill the demands of the users in the web. So we got new, or maybe not so new, idea to deal with that. So distributed systems, microservices. Any one of you lucky enough to work in this interesting world? One person? Okay. A bit more. Don't be so shy. Come on. And yeah, I mean, this solved not only the problem of dealing with scale, but also with scale of the user base, but also the scale of teams, right? Because as the software grows, you have more and more people touching the code base, so it was a good idea to slice and dice it and give teams autonomy / don't mess with my piece that much, because that's my service. It, however, introduces different set of challenges, right? As we say in Polish, the uncle changed the axe to the stick, right? So he didn't benefit much.
The uncle changed the axe?
The axe to the stick. Okay. So not the great deal. I mean, just a joke. Coming from the monolith world, where everything was a single process, one box, and pretty much an isolated world, we came with sort of expectations that the network is reliable, right? So it's always there, nothing happens, we don't have dropped packages, everything is super smooth, right? There are no infra failures on the way. We took it as granted, it's a fallacy of distributed computing. Then we also assumed that latency is zero, like instant feedback, instant response, everything happens automatically. And that bandwidth is infinite, so we can throw in enormous amount of data, we still get the response on time, because everything in monolith was in memory, so it's kind of constrained or limited by the box you are having, right? And it costs nothing, right? The transport cost is zero, which is not really the case when you go to the cloud. But, I mean, all in all, what we want as developers is we want to be super fast, right? We want to code the change, we want to run the test, and we want to know that at least to some extent we are confident we can ship it. So if we look at how it was or is with monolith architecture, it was fairly simple. I mean, we run Maven install or some Gradle target or Ant, please forgive. And was pretty much it, right? And then we probably wanted to deploy it somewhere, so there was this deploy script, or maybe from the IDE if you like to click around, but that was it, essentially. And on top of that, we didn't actually have, after a few years, this kind of excuse, that when you are compiling, you have to wait a lot of time, especially when we talk about JVM, because that's where I'm coming from, that's the tools I know. So we have incremental compilations, we have hot swap, we have, or had JRebel, right? So it was kind of improved. That was not the excuse we could legitimately use to drink infinite amount of coffee. When we dive into the distributed world or containerized world, that takes a few more steps. I mean, obviously we have to build first, right? But then we have to build the image as well. Or actually, this can be combined, just for the sake of the example. But when we have the image, then we have to make it available somewhere so that our cloud can fetch it and deploy. And we changed this shell script written by someone who is not in the company anymore and everyone is scared to touch it, to this humongous YAML, which I personally cannot comprehend. So I'm not sure which one is the X, which one is the stick, to be honest with you. But even leaving this aside, I mean, these are few steps which are not taking fractions of seconds. Right? The Docker build can take a while. If network is slower, then Maven is also probably having some hiccups. Then pushing is another thing. So I would say it's maybe 1, 2, or 3 minutes. So hey, we can go drink some coffee and do stupid things faster with more energy. That's what we can do. So obviously, developers who started doing cloud-native development, they were not some new people taken out of some vacuum. They were people who knew the previous approaches and tried to figure out if they can somehow address the pain points. So if you look at the landscape as is right now, maybe just a few examples. You have two open source tools, the Scaffold, which right now it's, I think, 1.0 general availability, and Draft from Microsoft. But then you also have the other smaller startups which are trying to address the same space. This essentially gives you a fast build push, as it's called, inner loop of development, so that you don't really spend much time on these Docker daemon cycles. It's all happening very fast thanks to those tools. I think Scaffold is one which is evolving very fast, and it's interesting to look at. I personally just look at those two, but I heard about those being kind of popular. So if we think about the inner loop development, this can be something you can look at. But then we go to troubleshooting, right? So if something happens on prod, so like, what do we do? I mean, we look at logs, right? We look at some traces. Print statements, maybe? But these are all after the fact, right? Something which happens, and we ideally would like to have a way to reproduce and go step by step, figuring out what's going on. And if we are talking about one or two, let's say, Java services which we run in the container, that's fairly easy because you can just do port forwarding and do remote debugging. That's all fine. But reality is not as simple as all the presentations at the conferences or Java user groups. You happen to have the Python service, then the Golang service, and all of a sudden, all what you would like to do with debugging gets a bit more tedious. So there's one tool which I highly recommend you having a look. I don't have a live demo for it, unfortunately. But there's a little startup with a bunch of Red Hat people, actually. Solo.io, and they are right now more focusing on making a service mesh spec. So it's not Istio and Linkerd and any others competing, but having some sort of, you know, standardized way of defining how the service mesh should look like. But the other product they have, which they actually use for writing the other stuff, is Squash. And it's essentially a debugger for microservices. It has a command line tool, and it has two extensions, as far as I know, and last time website I checked was yesterday. They have a VS Code, and then there is a separated repo with the JetBrains plugin. And I heard that Eclipse is coming, if anyone is using Eclipse. Should wait. So how does it work from like 3,000 feet overview? So there are two sides of the equation, right? It's one which is initiated by you as developer. So you open the Squash plugin, the IDE, or the command line, then you select the pod and the container you want to debug. And then you are done, you just put the breakpoints. And on the server side, there is a component used by Squash which sets up all the things around the pods and adding the debug set settings for you, so that you can connect with it, and then it will delegate to the services you want to develop. So you can actually develop not only one, but multiple services at once. You can have three VS Codes, for example, and just having a session and going through the initiating the traffic, let's say, from the browser, right? And then you can go back and forth and see what's happening in the particular microservice. Go, just quickly, the only difference is that this is attaching Delph at some point. They also have a support for Python, and they do have a support for C++, and I think that's all I can remember. When you use the CTL, Squash CTL, it's a nice interactive prompt when it shows you what kind of languages are currently available. Right, so that's one of the options which you can do in the cloud, but we tend to use the tools of our choice we love the most, like, for example, other IDE than those which are supported. And from my experience working with some of the distributed system, which I will come back to later, people have this tendency / love to run things locally. And therefore, you have things like Minikube, or we had in Red Hat Minishift, which is right now code-ready containers, but this is still a heavy stuff, and it's fine if you have four services, right? I mean, it's easy to spin it up if you have 64 gigs of RAM, like I have on my machine, then maybe you can think about 25, 26, but as long as you have, as soon as you have Kubernetes and Istio, and maybe something else in there, that's gonna be more challenging. And I mean, obviously, the services graphs are growing, and we are not talking about 5 or 10 microservices. I mean, latest thing I've seen from Monzo is that they have 1500s. Like, imagine running that on your local machine. I mean, it's pretty much that's what you're gonna get in no time. And I was a bit concerned if I'm gonna make the demo running for you, also because of the internet. I hope it will run. I mean, it looked like it's working, the cluster is up. So I was trying with the code-ready containers and Minikube, and with Istio I was hitting 90-something degrees on my CPU. So I guess I need to take my thermal paste again and clean it and put a new one. So there are other tools which can address this problem, because at the end of the day, if you are in the team working on the particular service, that's most of the time just one service you want to change. There is no need of ending up in this situation, so that you just pretty much blow up your resources. The tool which I find in particular interesting, it's called Telepresence. Anyone heard about Telepresence yet? So this tool is, I think, in a, I'm not sure if it's called Incubator or is it called Sandbox, but it's a part of a CNCF project, so CNCF organization. It's a tool which is kind of magical, but you don't have to think much about what's going on under the hood. It's using some VPN and DNS, IP tables, crazy stuff. But it boils down to this simple trick, that if you have those ABC services and you start Telepresence, it will swap the deployment, putting in the Telepresence proxy in it, and then you are developing using your favorite tools locally, let it be IDE or VS Code or whatever Vim you like, but you only run this single process, and the rest is going through the actual cluster. This can be production, this can be staging, however you have it organized, but you only run this single one and the rest of the traffic goes through the actual cluster. So you actually communicate with the real services running in the Kubernetes cluster. So with that, I think I'll try the demo. Just to show you a little bit how it looks like. So here I have, obviously, a very sophisticated microservices architecture of the Hello World scale plus two. I have a sequential, I can actually show it in the diagram, sequential or a chain of services where I call the customer service, which gets me the preference and also aggregate some recommendations. Easy peasy, not so scary. So what I want to do right now, and you see that this is a very neat demo application. Everyone is so excited about, so colorful, and yeah, that's what you do when you work in the real IT industry, right? You have the simple response and you curl in every 5 seconds. But anyway, what I want to do is I want to introduce some change in the recommendation service. And I don't have any Docker, I don't have any Minikube right now, just please trust me. What I'm gonna to do is I do the telepresence. And then I say swap deployments, and I would like to swap the deployment which is called recommendation v1, which sits in this namespace, which is unnecessary if it's your current context, but just for be safe with the demo gods, I say it explicitly. Then you have a bunch of methods on how this proxy should behave. So one is to inject TCP, and then there is the VPN setting which you can use. Then you say which port should be exposed, so where it sits in your cluster and what should be open. And then what kind of command you want to invoke. Right, so in this simple case I'm using Quarkus. I guess there was a presentation by Ivan earlier this year where you could still wear shorts in June. So if any one of you haven't heard about Quarkus yet? Everyone. So that's it's like a Spring Boot, but better. It boils down to having a set of all the standardized APIs from beloved Java EE. So JAX-RS, you have JPA, you have CDI, plus the Vertex for Reactive, and a lot of integrations with Camel or whatnot, and the micro profile. And you build your application and you run it as a single process. So far, it looks like Spring Boot. But the interesting part here is that it comes with the GraalVM integration. So it builds. You can build the native image. And then the Golang fans can't say anymore that your Java image takes half a gig of memory because it takes 30 megs. Right? So it's like Golang. Seems to be way more efficient and very cloud native friendly. But it also has this nice feature of the interactive development. So I will start this command, and then whenever I do some changes, it will reload the service and apply my changes instantly. So, fingers crossed. Let's see. And I'll be explaining what's going on right now. So, it starts telepresence. Giving you some details about mounting the volumes, because you can share the volumes and secrets from your local machine to the cluster. Obviously, you have to have privileges. It's not like any developer can have access if he has no admin rights. But what happened here is you see that one of the recommendation pods disappeared. And right now there is another one with this hash. I'm not really able right now to show you what's inside, because my nice little tool called K9S, which I highly recommend if you like CLI, will let you go to each and every pod and see the logs and see the images. I will show you after the talk in the larger screen, right? So you will have a chance. But it's I would show you right now that this pod has actually a telepresence proxy in it. It's not any kind of your image with your code, it's just the proxy image. And you see that right now I have a process running here, and since the curl is hitting my service, you see the responses here, the logs here, but also the response which now has my hostname, right? So I go to my favorite IDE, which is, I think, Vim, and I have this resource recommendation, and I'll just change one line here. I will say, knows how to exit green. I have a nice explanation for this abbreviation in Polish, but it's explicit, so I will skip it. But what happened right now, you see that Quarkus kind of reload something, and then you instantly see the response, this is hitting the actual cluster, right? So I go to the customer endpoint, or the route, which I defined before, and this goes to my Kubernetes cluster being somewhere in the most unstable Amazon East 1 zone you can ever imagine. So that's why I was a bit concerned if it's going to work. But this process is running on my machine, but all the rest is still running in the cluster, right? So it's pretty handy. And if I kill it, you will see that this is gonna be created, the other one will be terminated, it already died. Now you see that there's connection refused because this guy is not up and running yet. But right now we are back to square one. So that's telepresence in a nutshell.
One question, please.
Sure. Anytime you have a question, just shoot me.
Okay, so how do you install telepresence on the cluster, on the Kubernetes cluster?
So it will do it on its own, right? It will swap the it will save your deployment or deployment config, depends if you run OpenShift or Kubernetes. It will save it within your session, and it will replace it with a new one with all the settings except of triggers, I think, and we will say, okay, now use this image. So it will be the, that's what I barely wanted to show you, but I am not able right now.
Okay.
But I can try with the terminal later. But in this telepresence image, you won't have your recommendation V1, whatever git hash you have from the build image. You will have just the proxy. And the code is running on your machine.
On your local machine, exactly.
Okay, right. Any other questions?
How do you proceed if you have many instances or many pods?
So right now, that's a very good question. Right now, telepresence doesn't allow you doing that. But in 7 days, from what I heard at KubeCon, there's a new version coming out. They made a public announcement, which will be way more improved and will handle multiple instances. Because right now, I mean, since it's dealing with all the IP table stuff, they have some limitations to do multiple pods being run from your local machine. So it's right now it's a single instance, right? But I think with this new one which is coming out, it's changed. So you will be able to do. I think they are kicking out the old VPN methods.
But basically, you can start multiple command prompts, and for each microservice, you can start new telepresence.
Not right now. Not right now, it will blow up. You can do it. You can only do it for one. That's a limitation.
Is it secure to do so?
It depends who you ask, I guess. Or what's your actual cluster? It's not that secure, I know.
If everyone can swap the implementation.
Well, but I mean, if you have a developer account which can do that, right, then that's okay, right? Because you have those privileges.
There's an open port.
Right.
In your
deployment. Yeah, it's a security hole. That's true. But if you have, I think if you have strict policies, so it's a bit beyond telepresence. But you have strict policies of from which networks and how you, with actual login or whatnot, then I don't think it's a much of an issue. Right.
But you just change your local view of that microservice, right?
No.
No, if you check this URL on your machine, on your phone right now, that would give you the same response. And that's why I have this other tool which I want to show you.
Okay.
Which is built on top of it. Right. Any other questions? I'll just check what I have changed here. Right. As a quick recap. So for the build speed, so to optimize your inner loop, so local development, build, push, deploy, I think the scaffold is interesting thing to look at. For debugging, I think the squash, which I guess has the same concerns as telepresence anyway, because it's still open port, right? That's another thing you can have a look at. But if you want all of the above, plus not being limited to what ID is supported, then telepresence is a very appealing option. But you might wonder, why am I even talking about those tools? Is it like yet another talk showing you all the shiny things in the world? So, yeah, not quite, because that was born in pain. When I joined Red Hat, we had this product, which was called OpenShift IO. And it had the very interesting vision. The reason why I'm talking about this in the past tense is that it obviously doesn't exist anymore. But lots of the pieces which I'm going to explain briefly landed in OpenShift. Right, so I will tell you what this thing was and how it now translates to OpenShift. So we had the idea of having a frictionless from your project idea to deploy path, all in this software as a service suite. So we had issue tracker. You can think about it as Jira, right? We had a built-in cloud IDE based on Eclipse Chat, which we still have, and that's part of OpenShift's offering. It's called Eclipse Chat as an open source or code-ready workspaces as a part of OpenShift stuff. Then we had the build pipelines, which were based on Jenkins. Right now they are based on Tekton, and actually the guys who are working in the build pipelines on OpenShift IO right now, the core contributors to Tekton. We also had or have analytic services for scanning the vulnerabilities in your dependencies or containers, and this is also right now not part of this software as a service thing, but part of the OpenShift, and you can actually use it from VS Code and from Jenkins and I think from IDEA. Right, and that was more or less the whole thing with all the automation in between and different views on who can do what, managing teams and pretty much doing everything what's concerned about project development slash evolution within this nice thing. But that was before, and we had a lot of interesting challenges when we started. We obviously didn't start with, you know, microservices everything. We started with few reasonable services, let's say, because we didn't know how we're gonna grow, you know, requirements were shaping up, and it was a bit easier. But we ended up with a lot of lots of moving pieces which were interdependent. So the UI part, the backend part, it was kind of a lot of people touching this, and it's kind of hard to manage. And that resulted in blocked PRs, right? Because there was something in, let's say, a staging cluster, which was already merged and working, but the other stuff was not adjusted yet, so it was, you know, had to be done in some sort of sequential slash reviewed manner. The cluster was a problem because it was not as the prod, right? It never is. And we had obviously all the people wanted it barely to run in Minishift. And as I said, there were issues with production too, because we deployed to staging, everything looked nice, but then we ended up in prod and it turned out that some config maps were different or some other things were slightly changed, or we were running different images or different versions of Kubernetes. So yeah, this is quite a lot of things to keep in mind when you have different environments you use for dev and for serving your users. It's hard to keep in sync, right? It's not only about the infrastructure, but also about the database state. It costs extra, right? I don't remember the numbers right now by heart, but that was a substantial cost. You are never sure if it's gonna work when you hit production, at least from my experience. Not sure if you have more confidence. But with Kubernetes and Istio, you can mitigate it, but we didn't have these kind of things yet, and that's why we started working. But with all of these things I've mentioned, I mean, you end up with frustrated developers being unproductive and angry. And that's pretty bad, because it can end up with people losing their interest in the project. So we started at some point doing a little bit of research with cheesy slash promising goals we had in mind. So we wanted to have a way to easily validate what we have just changed but without messing up with others and other users who were already using the prod cluster. But we also wanted to run our service interacting with the actual services in the cluster because we wanted some data, we wanted the authorization and other services which you can't really have on your local machine. But we also wanted to be productive and run it in on our machines because Che is a great piece of technology, but it wasn't there yet. Right now it's way better because it was actually rewritten from scratch. Right now it's just a name state, but it's an entirely different architecture. But back then, we couldn't develop our stuff in Che. We couldn't even develop Che in Che. So that was a challenging thing. The tool we built is based on Kubernetes and works with Red Hat OpenShift, which is an enterprise-grade version of Kubernetes, which comes with extra security things and nice console and a few other goodies. Another thing we looked at was obviously telepresence, because we played it with before and we found it sufficient for our needs. Except of that, we wanted to have a way to not mess with the others, because if you say, I changed this pod, then every other person who is using the same cluster will hit your service, right? There was no orchestration involved, which will figure out if, let's say, Ivan is the guy who should see my new version of, let's say, invoice service written in, I don't know, Rust, right? Which is half-baked. And therefore, we have a look at the service mesh, and since Istio was getting into OpenShift at that point, which is right now supported, that was a natural step. So from the high-level overview of what Istio is, I mean, it boils down to the idea of externalizing all the infra and network aspects outside of your service, so that you only develop so-called business logic and you don't care about the network. And my battery is dying. Sorry about that. This is what happens when you open video. Only 40 minutes. No hacking in play. So you don't care about the actual names of the services or the actual locations. You don't care about the access rights. You don't care about the failovers. I mean, you could, but it's all handled by Envoy and Istio, right? So it's kind of a way of externalizing all the uninteresting bits for the software developer and just having that run side by side in the sidecar containers. So the few things from Istio which I just want to highlight is the first, obviously, the security, all the policies, all the rules you can define outside of your app, and that will be handled by the Envoy proxy. Then the next good thing is that you have all the metrics you can define provided through Prometheus, and based on metrics you can also define some rate limits or whatever kind of things you can make your services depending on, let's say. The fail recovery, even though you can use resilience for J or Hystrix, this can be easily handled just by simple YAML, which is defined by Istio. Timeouts, retries, all these circuit breakers things, this is externalized and managed by Istio for you. Then we come to the more interesting part of how to what you can apply Istio, and for example, one of it is a traffic mirroring. So you could use Istio to implement so-called dark launches. So if you have heard how Facebook rolled out their new chat, I think that was them who coined the term of dark launches. They had two chats, one which you were using and the other one which was written in Elixir, and all the traffic was split to both. So they were observing how the new service behaves, and after a while they make a switch. So Istio can do it for you, except of all this reasoning slash when to do it, because for that you need extra tools, right? Istio is just the basic building block for that, but it can do the mirroring for you. So if you have things like, for example, Diffie from Twitter, which can compare request responses between two copies of the service, then you have already something which helps you do the dark launches. And for us with telepresence, the most interesting bit was obviously the routing, so the traffic splitting. So based on some preconditions, we could say, if I'm Ivan and log into my app, I will hit my new version of the server service, whereas you as a regular user, you still go to the one which is proven to be working. So don't want to go that much deeper into the Istio itself, but I have a few interesting resources for you. This will be published or is already on GitHub, but the first two things are the talks. So this is an explanation how Istio can be used for canaries and dark launches and all these other DevOps agile approaches for rolling out your new changes. The other one is kind of a hardcore deep dive to what happens with the packet when it arrives to Istio. It's a 3 hours session from DevOps. But if you have enough courage or you're brave enough, it's worth listening. Then there is the tutorial from Red Hat developers, which is a step-by-step guide of configuring various flavors and aspects of Istio. And there is a free book from a few of my Red Hat colleagues. I think it was published by Aurel. I mean, it's not super thick, but it has all the essentials in it. And with that, let's meet Ike. That's the tool we've been researching on for the last few months. So right now it comes with two flavors. So the first aspect of it is the operator. So you install the operator in your cluster or in your namespace, and it will set up all the necessary resources we use to do these extra things on top of telepresence. And then there is the CLI tool, which you use for local development. So with that, no diagrams, just the code. So here I have the same version of this amazing microservice app, but you might have noticed it's a bit different. First, you have two containers within each pod. So one is the Istio sidecar proxy, and then there is a new pod which is the workspace which takes care of handling the metadata for creating those new services. And I have three different versions, which are right now the same, because they are hitting essentially the same service, which you can see here in Kali. So Kali is observability console, as they call it.
Sorry for being late.
Sure. And this shows the traffic flow in all your service mesh in Istio. It started as a Red Hat project, but right now it's the official part of Istio. So you will see how it will change when we're gonna apply a few changes to the code. Okay, where were I? Right. So I'll do. I killed this one for a second because apparently I have one pain too less. I will go to my recommendation service, and right, I just reset heart like I do every weekend, and then I do Ike, I say develop, and I say I want to develop similarly to the recommendation deployment, exposing the port, that's what I want to run so far, telepresence, namespace, and then I say if I have a route with the feature Y, that's where I'm gonna hit, right? So I'm gonna do that. It starts telepresence underneath, and then you can see that it doesn't kill the other pods, but it starts a new one. And you see that the local right now, which is already checking, the curl is checking with my header, it's not showing anything, right? Because it's not instant in the cloud. You have to. It eventually will arrive. Because maybe. Right, so now I'm in the local stuff, right? And I'm hitting the service, so I'm gonna do the Vim stuff again. Now you see, it's already changed, right? And if we have a look at Istio, the service mesh, there were failures because the pod was not available. But you see that the V1 version is there, but there is also new service, which only I can hit with the header, and that goes down to my service here. Should be green in a few seconds, I hope. Right, so that's the local inner loop. And if we want to go further with that, let's say we are happy with the change. So we can kill telepresence. So it will remove the pod for us. You see that was green in a second. This will disappear in a minute as soon as the Kubernetes will deal with termination. I go to my code again and I say, then I do the branch. Let's say I name it feature X. I push it to my demo repo. In the meantime, we are back to the square one, everything talks with production. Right, and then what I want to say is I want to watch on the PR. So that's a pull request. Which is not created yet, so now I'll try to do that. Okay. It's always hard. Okay. So now you see we just have this one service, everything is back to the original state. And I refresh this guy. So I can create a pull request. Create the pull request, and now we use Ike as a part of the CI/CD orchestration, and it's not integrated with anything, it's just whatever tool you use, you can simply just use the few CLI commands and it will do the same or similar trick. The difference is that in this case it will not do the telepresence, it will just create the new deployment and define the routes in Istio. Because there is no need to run telepresence process on the build server, right? It's just you have the code, you build it, and you don't change it yet. So that goes with GitHub Actions. It might take a few seconds. So if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer.
So this is going to make a separate deployment.
Right. Yeah. Right, but it will define the routes based on the GitHub SHA or the feature branch name, or whatever you define as the differentiator, and then you will go to the then you will go to this service only.
This is booting where?
That's a Ubuntu image, presumably somewhere in Azure, right? Because GitHub is now Microsoft. So. But the so GitHub Action is, I mean, we don't have any integration with GitHub Action. We just have GitHub Action, which is calling our tool, right? And it says, having access to the cluster, do that.
How is it accessing your tool?
Underneath, it's just using Kubernetes API. So you need a token and you need
a public API.
Right. You need a token and the API endpoint. So it's essentially what every other tool is doing.
was a little bit late, but I didn't catch because the lecture is about development on prod or testing prod. How do we prevent that any bugs don't get released actually?
Right. So that's
on the on production environment. So this is very fancy called here. Some rethink juggling, but the idea is there such a stable version to be deployed?
Right, so this lets you test your stuff on prod, or even change it on the fly on prod, but without affecting the actual...
Without any prior testing, no stage, no dev testing, no
UAT. That's the grand plan, yeah. True. I mean, there are ifs, and there are tricky bits like... how to deal with the state, right? I mean, you can use some virtual databases to dump your stuff, or some special ways of inserting your records so that only you know. It's not a silver bullet for everything, but this tool lets you define your services network, which is, I guess, here right now. I
hope, but it's automated?
Yeah. Right, so this is a PR, you see, it's already, so it's hitting the actual cluster, but the changed code is shown only on this route, whereas the actual flow is still the old one.
How do you differentiate?
So, I differentiate through headers, right? I say my session ID is this, right? And this is how I also define the...
So, who says that this header is only for this pull request? You set it up locally, or?
So if you do it locally, you say it here, right? Right here.
Yeah,
so you set the route with the header that, right? But in the GitHub action, you say the same, except that you don't use the develop, you say use the preview or something like that, right? It's a different strategy, but all the other things are pretty much applied the same way, because that's the virtual service and destination rule in Istio, which will take care of saying, okay, if you come to me with this header, I reroute you to this service.
So you can automatically put a lot of all the different branches and with different headers?
If you want to, yes, right?
Cool.
Not sure if cool, but interesting. So,
Who's running the container now?
Who's running the
pull request container?
No, so the pull request, the only thing it did, it ran the action, and action deployed to the cluster using the tool. I mean, it's a bit of a humongous YAML, but I'm not sure.
You don't like YAML.
So, build recommendation. Find some how it should be when it's triggered, right? Then you do this, right? So essentially, you just deploy the image,
but the container is running,
and then
where
you say,
all the other containers are running, right?
So we have our own container which is called Action Checkout, and it has this CLI tool built in, right? But this is just a matter of having convenient way of delegating it, because you could just use, you know, plain Ike stuff here, right? But this way it's nicer because it's YAML and it's DSL. Right?
But if you have like Jenkins and
then you just do like with Docker. If your Jenkins has a Docker available for your politically incorrect word slaves, but that's how it's called. you can just say Ike creates and pass all the this is translated to the CLI underneath. Right, and this is the thing you are interested in, right?
Yeah.
And this says feature X. Right? And this is the image which we just built right here.
So if you have two large hypervisors and this runs only the tested containers, you can have a second one that runs all the garbage containers by developers that are testing, so you don't populate the first one. So you can do that.
Yeah, that's the idea. Okay, good. So, yeah, that's the demo, I think. Right, so, and you don't have to do everything in the console. If you want yet another YAML, we have a simple mapping for the flags, which is built-in feature of Cobra. Yeah, so we want to invest a bit. We are a small team, mind you, just two. We want to be investing IDE integration, so probably the VS Code will be the first thing which we're gonna start maybe even this Christmas. Because this will also gives us a way of using the same plugin in Czech, because TIA IDE, which Chase built on top of, is kind of VS Code. It supports the VS Code extensions. More CI/CD use cases, of course, because that's a very simple stuff. But for that, I need you to give it a try and give me the actual needs, so I can be happy, not sitting in the ivory tower figuring out stuff. Right? Because if we have more interesting projects using it, they all have different ways of dealing with things and different needs. So if you get something which is not working, or you have some other needs, we are happy to, we are thrilled to do it. And it's all open source. Obviously. And since it's open source, that's the GitHub repo, where you can find all our stuff. We have, I hope, pretty good docs. We don't have any cheesy ASCII GIFs yet, but I'll do that fairly soon. And we are not the only ones. We are not geniuses here. We got inspired by the talk from a guy who worked in Namely back then. They did a very similar approach for their microservices. Our differentiator is that it's open source, so you can just use it. No cost, code is available, you can always contribute or give us your feedback. Works on every Kubernetes cluster out there. But also Azure Dev Spaces are kind of tackling the same problem space. So it's a very similar line of thoughts. And the Google Cloud Code is pretty much aiming for the same as telepresence and squash mixed together. And that's all I have, I guess. So that's me. I did a bit intro at the beginning, which I normally don't do. This, you probably need a magnifying glass to see those. But my first name, last name, that's my GitHub. So you can see what I'm hacking on. A bit of Arquillion. I think that's all I have right now. So thanks a lot. Any questions? Happy to answer. Or I can show you the Q9S stuff.
What was the name of the Arquillion